Good morning, it's Ophelia. We're here again for the Samhita story time with Miss Lily. We're gonna wait for a few minutes while everybody gets set up. We're in my living room again, so bienvenidos. We're gonna grab a cup of coffee. If moms, dads, guardians, grown-up friends, whoever's watching, grab yourself your tacita de café. Kiddos, grab some tea, some, I don't know, hot chocolate, a cup of milk, your cereal. If you're in your PJs, that's perfectly okay. I did brush my hair today, and I'm not like descalza, and I am, I guess, presentable today. But if you are just chilling in your PJs and just kind of hanging out, that's okay too. It's Saturday morning. So I am going to step out so I can go grab my cup of coffee, and then we'll be right back. And then Miss Lily is enjoying her cup of coffee and playing with the cat. Maybe I'll swap over so you can meet Junie. That's Junie, our gatita. And Miss Lily. And Junie is just chilling here, and my daughter wanted me to have coffee this morning in the Junie mug, and we actually got this mug at Maroche's Bakery for the Hecho con Amor market a couple of weeks ago, and we got it from, I think it was Fresa Thrift, and they're women of color owned little thrift store that does little pop-ups around town and really cool stuff. So showing that off. And the book that we'll be doing this morning, one of them is called Pelitos, and we have the video already uploaded where Iris Candelaria walks you through an activity, a collaging activity, and that's our July activity for the month. But we I will be at actually Recipe O'Clip later today from 1 to 3 p.m. and we'll have art kits. You also will get a little semillitas magnet that you can actually cut out and you can color. Then there is also a, trying to think what else. So you'll get the art kit for the collaging, the magnet, oh, a little mandala, do-it-yourself mandala template that you can kind of really design your own mandala with and then color it so that you have a mandala to make and color. And mandalas are great for stress relieving because you have to really focus on what you're doing. And then I'm also including pipe cleaners and beads so that you can make your own bubble wand. And I will have links on social media and our website for the mandala activity. And it's just from a website that I liked, but it explains the history of it. No, Junie, you cannot have coffee from the Junie cup. It explains the history behind mandalas, and then it kind of walks you through drawing your own mandalas. And then I'll also have a link to an activity that shows you how to make your own bubble one. And we'll have a lot more stuff this month. So I just wanted to share that before we get into the storytelling and trying to get what else. I haven't had my coffee yet, so I'm a little scattered. I think that's it, but we'll be at Recipe O'Cliff today from 1 to 3 p.m. On the 17th, we're going to do like a full day of giveaways. We'll be at Owenwood Farm and Neighborhood Space from 10 to 12, then at Recipe O'Cliff from 1 to 3 p.m., and then at Marocha's Bakery for the Etchopan Morton Market from 6 to 10 p.m. So on the 17th, we'll get all the giveaways done, and we'll also have free books. Don't forget that. I've gotten a lot of book donations, so I'll have 2 bookcases full of books at Recipe O'Cliff and at each of the sites this month. And then Miss Lily will be doing story time again later this month, and we will be having Samita's book club for 3rd to 5th graders this month as well, but it will be virtual. So just kind of be on the lookout for that. And I think that's it. I feel like I'm running through this list, but I think that's it. And if you weren't here last week, for the last story time, then you didn't get to meet Miss Lily, but she is a dear, dear friend, someone that I've known for a long time. We won't say how long, but long time. My kids, my husband, everybody loves her. Pets love her, and she's an amazing artist. She's an amazing poet. She has a lot of experience with like mental health issues and just kind of working in that field, and so she's just a lovely, lovely person. And I'm gonna let her come over here, and she can tell you a little more about herself, and then she'll tell you some stories, and then you'll get to love her too.
Hi, everybody. So nice to see most of you, hopefully, and some of you new faces. So like Ophelia mentioned, I'm an artist, I'm a poet, I'm a writer, and for the most part, a lot of that is self-taught. I didn't go to school for that. The wonderful Silvana Alonso told me once that if you write, you're a writer, and but and she shared that with me, and I really took it to heart. So some of you kiddos out there that write poetry or journal or just write for yourself, you know, if you write, you're a writer. So if you draw, you're an artist. So just think of yourself as what you want to become, and that's how things happen. So I'm gonna get started with a book here from a writer that a lot of your parents might also be familiar with, her name's Sandra Cisneros. And I actually didn't know she had written a kid's book till last week when Ophelia shared this book with me. And so that's really neat because she's an amazing writer for adults. So I'm excited that, you know, she's also written for kids because it's a good introduction into her work. It's a good introduction into you know, when some of you get older, you'll kind of start seeing more of yourself in literature, and sometimes you have to look for it. A lot of the books that are out there, you may not see yourself in them, and I remember that for myself. Judy wants to drink coffee for some reason. But, you know, knowing this name, Sandra Cisneros, it's going to help lead you to other writers like Ana Castillo. My brain don't work yet, so I can't think of a lot of the other authors that I'm familiar with that, you know, Ophelia introduced me to 400 years ago when we were younger. So I'm going to get started with Sandra Cisneros. This book is called Pears, or Pelitos. And again, it's both in English and Spanish, just like one of the books from last week. She's the writer of a very famous book called The House on Mango Street. And I say very famous because it's taught in a lot of high schools and colleges, and it's super important that we as people of color see ourselves in the curriculum, you know, in schools, in the school system. and that we look for other authors that, you know, look like us, look like our friends, look like our peers. You know, it's a very colorful world, and we got to do the work sometimes to find these authors and find these books and support them locally, nationally, globally. And so we're going to get started. So this book, it was illustrated by Carrie Ibanez, and turn this way so hopefully some of you guys with really good eyes can see. Some of you are not familiar with this. This is Three Flowers. Ask your dads about that. Everybody in our family has different hair. My papa's hair is like a broom, all up in the air. And me, my hair is lazy. It never obeys barrettes or bands. Carlos's hair is thick and straight. He doesn't need to comb it. Mandy's hair is slippery. It just slides out of your hand. And Kiki, who's youngest, has hair like fur. But my mother's hair, like little rosettes, like little candy circles, all curly and pretty, because she pinned it in pin curls all day. Sweet. Put your nose into when she is holding you. Holding you and you feel safe. It's a warm smell of bread before you bake it. It's the smell when she makes room for you on her side of the bed, still warm with her skin. And you sleep near her. The rain outside falling and Papa snoring. How many of y'all have Papas that snore? Or Mama's. The snoring, the rain, and Mama's hair that smells like bread. And I'm going to go ahead and read this one in Spanish also because it's a little short. And, you know, some of us are bilingual. And that's great. So some of you may not understand it, but at least you'll be able to get an idea of what is being said since you've already heard it in English. And it's okay if you don't understand it. It's not a big deal. You know, some of us are bilingual, and that's, you know, a beautiful thing, but it's okay. You know, you can always learn if you want to, and if you don't want to, that's not a problem either. We are who we are. Todos en nuestra familia tenemos pelo diferente. El pelo de mi papá es como una escoba, todo parado de punta. Y yo, mi pelo es flojo. Nunca obedece a broches o diademas. El pelo de Carlos es grueso y lacio. No necesita peinárselo.
I have a brother named Carlos, and this is very true.
El pelo de Nelly es resbaloso. Se escurre de tu mano. Y Kiki, el más chiquito, tiene pelo como peluche. Like a teddy bear. Pero el pelo de mi mamá, el pelo de mi mamá, como rositas, como rueditas de dulce, todas chinitas y lindas, porque se hizo anchoas con pasadores todo el día. Dulce cuando pones tu nariz en él cuando ella te abraza. When cuando te abraza y te sientes segura, es el olor tibio a pan antes de hornearlo. Es el olor cuando te hace un campito en su lado de la cama, todavía caliente de su piel. Y te duermes cerca de ella, la lluvia cayendo afuera y papá roncando. Los ronquidos, la lluvia y el pelo de mamá que huele a pan. Kind of reminds me of David Bowie. If you don't know who that is, you Google that.
Great musician.
Wonderful. So I am wearing my purple lipstick today, in honor of a tiny battle Sandra Cisneros had to have with San Antonio, the city in Texas, because she bought a house in a place that was historically important, meaning it had been there for a very long time. And so she painted her house purple because it's a color that she liked. Some of us like to have our houses really bright. I know I do. And that's okay. But she got in a little bit of trouble because she didn't know that her house had to be painted a certain color. So she had to have a little tiny fight with the city. She did win. She did make adjustments, and you know, one of the important things that she found out in that battle was that you know, some of our history was not being kept. She didn't really find a whole lot of history of Tejano culture being recorded. So you know, just that's one really important thing about history is, you know, we ourselves can note down history. You know, our journals are important, our stories are important. You know, it's important to tell these stories to each other, to write. If you want to become a writer, that's something you can do. And you know, like I said, the purple lipstick for me reminds me of something that I learned probably 20 years ago. I did find out she did sell her house in 2015, so the purple house is no longer hers. I don't know if it's been kept purple. But, you know, it's little things like that that can remind you that we were there, and, you know, we are worth remembering, and it's also our job to take note of that history and to pass it on to each other. So this next book, it's called When We Were Alone. It's a book by an author named David A. Robertson, and the illustrator on this book is Julie Lett. And so we're going to get started on this one, and we can talk a little bit more. Today, I help my Cocom in her flower garden. She always wears colorful clothes. It's like she dresses in rainbows. When she bent down to prune some of the flowers, I couldn't even see her because she blended in with them. She was like a chameleon. Cocom, why do you wear so many flowers? I asked. Cocom said, well, no se siente. When I was your age, at home in my community, my friends and I wore many different colors. But at the school I went to, far away from home, they gave us different clothes to wear. All the children were dressed the same, and our clothes weren't colorful at all. We all mixed together like storm clouds. Why'd you have to dress like that? I asked. They didn't like that we were wore such beautiful colors, Nukom said. They wanted us to look like everybody else. But sometimes in the fall, when we were alone and the leaves had turned to their warm autumn hues, we would roll around on the ground. we would pile the leaves over the clothes they had given us, and we would be colorful again. And this made us happy. Now, Mokom said, I always wear the most beautiful colors. After I helped with the flowers, we went over to the back gate. There were vines covering the gate, and they reached all the way to the ground. When my Mokom turned to fix the latch, I saw that her braid hung almost as low as the vines. It was like she had a tail. Mokom, why do you wear your hair so long? I asked. Mokom said, well, Nosisin, when I was your age, at home in my community, my friends and I grew our hair long, just like our people had always done. It made us feel strong and proud. But at the school I went to, far away from home, they cut off all our hair. Our strands of hair mixed together on the ground like blades of dead grass. Why did you have to wear your hair like that? I asked. They didn't like that we were proud, Mokom said. They wanted us to be like everybody else. But sometimes in the spring when we were alone and the grass had grown so long and thick in the field, we would pick the blades from the ground. We would braid them into the short hair they had given us. And we would have long hair again. And this made us happy. Now, Mokom said, I always wear my hair very long. After Michael Holm had fixed the latch, I followed her to the birdhouse. There was a bird flying through the air like a jingle dress dancer. She fed the bird and whispered, Na inaisis, nikiso, tamisi kitigin, ta maskisigin. And her words sounded just like a poem. Mokom, why do you speak in Cree? I asked. Mokom said, well, Mosusin, when I was your age, at home in my community, my friend and I always spoke our language. But at the school I went to, far away from home, they wouldn't let us speak our words. All the children used their strange words, and we didn't understand them at all. Our voices blended together like a flock of crows. Why did you have to talk in your language? I asked. They didn't like that we spoke our language, Mokom said. They wanted us to talk like everybody else. But sometimes in the summer, when we were alone and our teachers weren't anywhere around the place where we would whisper to each other in Cree. We would say all the words we weren't allowed to say so that we wouldn't forget them. And this made us happy. Now, Mokom said, I always speak my language. After our gardening work was done, I sat with my Mokom in the backyard. Her brother came over and sat with us. He comes over all the time. We drank tea and ate banok. The tea was hot and sweet, and the banok was moist and warm and melted in my mouth. My Mokom and my uncle talked and laughed like children. Mokom, why did you and Uncle Misali spend time together? I asked. Mokom said, well, Nosisin, when we were your age, at home in our community, being with family was the most important thing. We played with each other, did chores together, and shared everything. But at the school I went to, far away from home, they wouldn't let us sleep together. My brother and I were separated like day and night. "Why were you and Nokomi separated?" I asked. "I didn't like when we were a family," Nokomi said. "Because when we were together, we thought too much of home." Sometimes, in the winter, when we were alone, and we were sure that nobody could see us, we would find each other. We would take off our mitts, and in the crisp, cold air, we would hold hands so we could be with each other. And this made us happy. "Now," Mukun said as she reached out over and held my uncle's hand in mine, "I'm always with my family." When We Were Alone is a very beautiful book. It's a book about something that a lot of people don't know about. For a long time in this country, in the United States, and this has happened in a lot of countries that were already, there were already people there when other people moved into it. In this case, the Europeans came into a country that already had people. And as you can tell, it can be very sad when people are taken advantage of. And so what happened here is these children were taken from their families and sent to schools to learn to be more American, to have their language taken away, their look, their image, their culture taken away. And so that word is called assimilation. It's a very fancy word for making people like each other, making people a blank slate. And that is not a necessary thing. You know, people have the right to who they are, and what happens when you do that to a culture is a very sad and ugly thing. It's the thing about this book is that you can see that that was survived, that these children survived that, and they use their memory, they use their love for each other. They use what they knew of what was important to them, and they brought it back little by little. And the most important thing is that they remembered and they shared that with their children and with their grandchildren. And so that's how you keep history alive. That's how you keep memory alive. The United States, as we all know, come from all over the place. But there was already people here before anyone else got here. That includes my people. I can't think of the phrase. Is it First Americans? Or, no, not. Is it?
Yeah, like a First People.
Right. The First Nation. You know, I mean, people call themselves what they want to call themselves. So some people might call them Native Americans. Some people might call them the First Nation. The best way to find out is to ask, what would you prefer to be called? That's important with anything. But I think what I really love about this book is just the many things it talks about, how you can maintain a connection with things that are taken from you. You know, this past year has been very hard for a lot of people. And one of the really great things that the grandma talked about at the end was when she would meet up with her brother, they would take off their mittens and they would touch. Touch is super important. super crucial. And sometimes we forget how, if you think of your grandma and how she had to be so protected this past year because of COVID, grandma needs to be touched. Grandma needs for you to go over there and touch her face, touch her hand. It's always good to ask first. But touch is super important. Touch is the way sometimes people who can't say the words say I love you to each other. It's okay to not always have the right words to say, but if you can touch somebody, they can feel. They can feel your heartbeat. They can feel what you're feeling on the inside in your heart. And so it's just, this is such a beautiful book. And, some of you older kiddos, you can go out there on the Google and just, do a search about Native Americans, what was called rehoming, and, that happened in Australia too, with the indigenous culture there, the Aboriginal people, very similar situation too. And, sadly, it's still something that continues to happen. And that's why we have to take care of each other. I may not be of the Cree Nation, but I know that I am Native American to some extent. And it's not just that. It's not just, I'm not only going to take care of Native Americans because that's what I am. If I see something happening to someone else, regardless of whatever nation they belong to, it is important for me to speak up for them when I can. It is important for me to speak up to people who can't speak up for themselves. And you can do that in little ways. It's scary sometimes to do the right thing, but it's possible to do the right thing in a lot of different ways. You can write about it, you can blog about it, you can talk about it, you can share what you learned today with other people. You can learn more about what's happening or what's happened in the past. It's really important to look to the past so that we can find out the things that we didn't do well, so that we don't do them again. Because it's important to just, take care of each other. More than anything in this world, it's important to be kind and to be loving and to be supportive of one another. And one of the best ways to do that is to learn about each other, to learn about not just the Cree Nation, but, to learn about other cultures, to learn about people who don't look like us, who don't talk like us, and to learn about ourselves too. We didn't all get to take on something like language. For example, I speak Spanish. I was born in Mexico. My parents were born in Mexico. And so it was easy for me to learn that language because I grew up in a home where everybody spoke Spanish. But not everybody had that. A lot of people, their parents may have been born in Mexico, but when they got here, they were told, you can't speak Spanish here, and that's scary. And so they stopped speaking Spanish, and they were kind of forced to speak English. And so for them, they were scared to teach their children Spanish. I have a friend who told me when she was in school, she's older, maybe in her 60s now, and she told me how hard it was growing up in the South, in South Texas, just, taking her lunch to school, and she had tacos, everybody else had sandwiches, and how hard that was, and how mean people were. And so she stopped speaking Spanish. It scared her. She didn't teach her children Spanish. And that's not her fault. That's called, something else. It's called trauma. That's a whole other conversation. But we have to be kind to each other. It can't be like, hey, you don't speak Spanish. No, we don't do that to each other. We have to be kind. And we have to be understanding. And we have to learn about history and why these things are going on now. Why people lost their culture and lost their language. You know, just remember, there's a reason behind a lot of things that we don't understand.
And I'm going to step in here, too, and just share that the reason that I picked a lot of these books is exactly, I hope I don't fall off of this, is exactly what Lily is talking about. Books today were bilingual. One was English and Spanish, and one was English and had words in Cree. And they're similar stories. And the beauty of these books is, and all of these stories is that even though we're different, a lot of times we're also very similar. And so I hope you enjoy these. And all of the books that are going to be on the story times have kind of a reason behind them. But I think that is a great example, and you gave some really important messages too, about just kind of how we treat each other and why it's so important to always be learning. And that's why I love books. That's why I love reading and writing. And part of like art too is history, and it's studying your family, and it's talking to like your grandparents and your elders and your tías and your tíos, and getting the stories that belong to you. And maybe you can write your own book one day, and maybe you can illustrate your own story one day, and there will be more books about all of us written out there. But I hope you like those, and I actually am going to be raffling off some of the books that we read last month on Wednesday. So if you got an art kit in June or May or even April, and you did some of the crafts, or you've been working on your bucket list, make sure to have your parents post about what you've done, or maybe share a picture, or even like just record a little message about what you've been doing, and have your parents tag at SimiEatUsBookClub.com on Facebook or Instagram, or if they want to message me or email me, that'd be great too. And whoever does that, I am putting your name in. I'm going to do it old school style. I'm not going to use the sorting app. I'm going to put your name in a little bowl. On Wednesday, I'll do a live video, pull out the names for the winners, and I'll have the books that we read last month. And so it was, I think, Rainbow Weaver, it was Pink is for Boys, and there were two other books that I did. We didn't do a live story time, but there were two other books, and I can't remember what those are. And then I'll have like some buttons and some cool little things for you. So make sure that you tag us. Deadline is Wednesday. And then remember, this video will be on Facebook and Instagram, and I think I'll do it on the YouTube channel too, so that you can listen to those stories. And however many times you want, but get that done by Wednesday. I think by Wednesday I'll do the drawing, the giveaway, at around maybe like 7 p.m. and I'll do it live on social media, so that we can get those prizes for you. And I don't know if you have anything else.
I did want to remind you guys that your grandparents, your tios and tías and parents, they were young ones. They used to be cool. So ask them questions. Write down their stories if you want. That would be a really great way to capture that history. And one of the things I kind of forgot in discussing this is the whole theme about this was about hair. Mm-hmm. So hair. Everybody has different hair. This isn't what my hair looks like. This is after I've, you know, done stuff to it. My hair is naturally curly, wavy, frizzy. So it takes a lot of work to look like this. So, you know, I mean, we all have a choice in what we want to do with our hair. I've shaved my hair completely off before. I've had purple hair, pink hair, black hair. That's my natural color. So, you know, I mean, look around you. We all have different hair for different reasons. And yeah, it's
love your hair.
Yeah, it's love it however you like it.
Mine is like silver and black now. My hair is normally black. When I was younger, my hair was like kind of wavy, just like all over the place, like really crazy. And now, as I've gotten older, it's gotten curly, which is like and kind of straight. One has really, really curly hair. My husband has really curly hair. My son has, when his hair is long, is kind of very full of volume, very like fluffy. But now that it's short, it's really like straight and spiky. And so I call my kids the Greñudo gang, because it's the Greñudo girls and the Greñudo guy, because they've always had like hair that does their own thing.
Yeah.
And that's okay. Your hair, sometimes, yes, your parents are going to be like, your hair has to be combed. And I'm guilty of that too. And like, put a chongo on. But then sometimes I'm like, whatever. Just let your hair be free and have fun. And that's just love your hair. And it can look however you want it to look. And it's just, hair is beautiful. It's a part of our personality, and it kind of shows who we are too.
Yep.
And the different colors. And yeah, I've had blue hair, like purple hair, different colors too, red. So go outside, enjoy the sun today. I think we're supposed to have sun. I don't think it's gonna rain.
It's
gonna
be in the 80s.
And we'll see you next time. We'll be back next time. I forgot to bring the book that we're going to be doing next week, but I'll post pictures of it and of them. And then hopefully I'll see you at some of the art kit giveaways and the book giveaways.
All right.
Bye.
Nice to see everybody.